Good morning. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. And please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The first item of business is general questions. In order to get as many people in as possible, short and succinct questions and answers to match would be helpful. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And I call Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its assessment is of the impact parental smoking has on child poverty.
Minister Marie Todd.
Reducing the use of and harm caused by tobacco products is one of Scotland's public health priorities. Given that smoking is more prevalent in our most deprived communities, in particular where there is a greater risk to children and young people from exposure to secondhand smoke, we have set specific smoking cessation targets for our cessation services, which are focused entirely on these communities. Eradicating child poverty is a national mission for this government, and we will set out further action to deliver at the pace and scale required as part of our next Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan, published in March 2022.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Billions of pounds has rightly been invested in protecting people from COVID-19, and yet smoking remains a huge killer also. Year on year, with 9,332 deaths in Scotland directly attributable to smoking in 2018. Given that smoking disproportionately impacts the most deprived households and taking into account the health and financial costs to families, what more will the Scottish Government do to help people quit smoking, enabling them to both improve their health and their financial circumstances?
Minister.
Mr. Gibson makes a very good point. Reducing health inequalities and increasing healthy life expectancy are priorities for the Scottish Government, and smoking has been the primary preventable cause of ill health and premature death for many years. The Scottish Government published its five-year strategy, Raising Scotland's Tobacco-Free Generation, in June 2018, and the action plan sets out interventions and policies to help reduce the use of and the associated harms from tobacco in Scotland. This plan focuses on the inequalities within groups of people that smoke, prevention and reduction of uptake of smoking among young people, and providing the best possible support for those people who want to give up. The Scottish Government have introduced a 2034 tobacco-free target. Our aim is to reduce smoking rates to 5% or below by 2034, creating a generation of people who do not want to smoke and are protected from the harms of smoking. The Tobacco Control Action Plan 2018 continues our work on protecting children from taking up the habit of smoking and creating a tobacco-free generation by 2034. And in addition, anyone who wants to stop smoking can contact the free NHS Stop Smoking Service, Quit Your Way Scotland. This free helpline provides advice and support and can direct individuals to local support services to help people find their own way to stub out this habit.
Thank you. Question number two, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to implement the recommendations of Scotland's Drowning Prevention Strategy.
Minister Ash Denham.
The Scottish Government takes the issue of water safety very seriously and welcomed the Drowning Prevention Strategy when it was published by Water Safety Scotland in 2018. And I'd like to thank Claire Adamson for her contribution to the strategy and her continued support to Water Safety Scotland, which has obviously a linchpin role in this area. And as you will know, the Scottish Government continues to provide funding via ROSPA to support the operation of Water Safety Scotland. And additionally, this year, the Scottish Government has worked with partners to support a number of water safety activities and campaigns. We also work closely with Water Safety Scotland and other partners to support the recommendations in its drowning prevention strategy and initiatives that can help raise awareness of the hazards around water and reduce deaths from accidental drowning. And on the 11th of August, I convened a meeting with a range of key stakeholders to drive further action around delivery of the drowning prevention strategy, and I'll be convening a follow-up meeting later on this month.
Claire Adamson.
And I thank the Minister for her response. We were all shocked and saddened at the numerous reports of drowning fatalities in Scotland, including my own constituencies, and we send our condolences to all those affected. And it is wonderful to see RoSPA and Water Safety Scotland developing a host of educational resources in school. The UNCRC Article 24 enshrines the right to access educational information on the prevention of accidents for children and their caregivers. What steps will the Scottish Government take to ensure that Article 24 of the UNCRC is realised for children in Scotland and that water safety education is promoted across our constituencies?
Minister.
I'm grateful that the relevance of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child has been highlighted today in the Chamber by the Member, and it's because we attach such fundamental importance to the rights and well-being of our children that we've legislated to incorporate the Convention as far as possible into Scots law. And when this Parliament voted in March unanimously to approve the legislation, it was a milestone and not an end point. And work needs to be ramped up to ensure that the Convention's provisions bring real life benefit to our children. And that applies to the provisions of Article 24, which relates to health and well-being, which includes that ensuring that all segments of society, in particularly parents and children, are informed, have access to education and are supported in the prevention of accidents. And we're not setting off, of course, from a standing start. A lot of good work on education around risk assessment and accident prevention is already being undertaken. And we also have the underlying contribution made by the Getting It Right for Every Child programme. So we have a very good platform on which to build. With specific regard to prevention of accidental drowning, we will absolutely be strengthening our work with key organisations, including Water Safety Scotland and RoSPA, to identify and deliver the most effective ways of facilitating access to appropriate education and support.
Jackie Bailey.
The Minister will be aware of the tragic drownings that have occurred at Loch Lomond this summer. Indeed, every year there are tragedies. Last year, following the tragic death of Ava Gray, I wrote to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to ask them to site a rescue boat at Balloch. It is currently sited at Knightswood, which is some 25 minutes away on a good day. I want to praise the work of the Lough Rescue Boat, but it's run by volunteers, and Loch Lomond is 39 kilometres long, so there is a clear need to do more. Will the Minister ensure that the location of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Boat is reviewed as a matter of urgency?
Minister.
I thank the Member for that answer. As I said in my previous answer, when I convened the meeting on the 11th of August, a range of stakeholders were there. As you would imagine, Scottish Fire and Rescue were there. I specifically asked Scottish Fire and Rescue to review the location of their assets for exactly that reason, to look at that going forward. And I think the Member is right to raise Loch Lomond. But I think also there's no simple single answer to the challenge of drowning prevention. So things like education, there's obviously a role for signage, for life-saving equipment, and all water can be dangerous, but the Member is right to point out that some locations where the dangers are more significant and where it's especially important that there's clear warning signage and appropriate life-saving equipment, and I will again speak to Scottish Fire and Rescue Service about this particular incident, and I will come back to the Member.
Question number three, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to tackle anti-social use of quad bikes, trail bikes and other off-road vehicles.
Minister Ash Denham.
I'm well aware of the risk to public safety caused by careless, inconsiderate and anti-social driving. And that's why I fully support Police Scotland and its partners in dealing with the misuse of vehicles in an appropriate and a proportionate way. And local policing teams are ideally placed to engage with members of the local community to identify where the misuse of vehicles is causing distress to the public. And that ensures that in those areas that they can be prioritised for proactive action to prevent future instances and identify and deal with those engaged in the misuse of vehicles.
Neil Bibby.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Yeah, over the summer, I've been taking surgeries to streets in my community, and I can tell the Minister there's growing concern about antisocial behaviour and the inappropriate use of quad bikes and other off-road vehicles. It's not only a danger to the rider, it's a danger to pedestrians and the wider public. Often the people most affected by this antisocial behaviour are the least likely to come forward with their concerns. So can I ask the Minister on their behalf, will she meet with me to discuss how we help Police Scotland make our communities safe and reclaim our footpaths, our parks and our public spaces from the dangerous antisocial minority who are misusing these vehicles?
Minister.
Of course, I'd be happy to meet with the Member to discuss this, but just for context, on the 13th of March in 2020, I asked my officials to write out to all local authorities in Scotland to ascertain the extent to which the antisocial use of motorcycles and quad bikes is a problem in their areas, and if it is a problem, how they're currently addressing it. And I'm pleased to say that all 32 local authorities replied to that request, and I can inform you that the antisocial use of motorcycles and quad bikes is not a widespread problem across Scotland. Six local authorities, though, did report that they had an ongoing problem with antisocial use of motorcycles or quad bikes in their area, and four of whom said it was a seasonal occurrence. But I would be happy to meet with the member to discuss this further if he would like.
Question number four, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to help protect people participating in football activities, particularly children and young people, in light of research suggesting a link between repeated heading of footballs and dementia in later life.
Minister Marie Todd.
The Scottish Government want people to take part in sport and physical activity within a safe environment. We're in regular contact with the Scottish FA to discuss a range of issues from developing the game to safety issues. The Scottish FA produced guidance with Dr. John McLean of the Hampden Sports Medicine Centre, which has provided clubs and coaches with a robust set of guidelines on heading. They are clear that they do not recommend heading practice in primary children's football, and they have a set of graduated guidelines for when they reach secondary.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Minister for her answer. The Minister will be aware of the sad news of the legendary Manchester United football player, Aberdeen-born and bred Dennis Law, who recently confirmed his diagnosis of mixed dementia. He believes repeated heading of footballs may have played a part in this. Policies such as Frank Laws are an excellent way to ensure support for people affected by dementia. So can I ask the Minister if the Scottish Government has plans to build on this landmark piece of legislation?
Minister.
Firstly, to note the announcement by Dennis Law that he is suffering from dementia. I think it's obviously I'm very sad about that, but I think it's great when people who are heroic and have a status that he does in our society stand up and say that they're suffering from that illness, and that reduces some of the stigma and fear for everyone else in the population. So I'm grateful for his doing that. In terms of support for people with dementia, we've been very clear over the course of this Parliament we'll substantially increase funding for both the NHS and social care. We're planning to increase public investment in social care by 25% over the Parliament, so that by the end of the Parliament we'll have budgeted over £800 million of increased annual support for social care compared to current spending. And that's absolutely necessary because at the moment in the general population, over 80s face a 1 in 3 risk of dementia. So we need to remain focused on this, and we will remain focused on this.
Question number 5, Sarah Boyack.
Can I apologise, Presiding Officer? I don't have this idea. Can I apologise to the Chamber for that? I wasn't ready to go there. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will commit to enshrining a rule in the National Planning Framework 4, where for every new building, 1% of the cost is given to the arts.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The Scottish Government will lay a draft National Planning Framework in Parliament this autumn for scrutiny, alongside a comprehensive programme of public consultation. As set out in our position statement last year, NPF 4 will include stronger planning policies to support our creative industries.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer? Will he accept that there's a need for increased investment in our arts? And one of the ways that can be do that, and indeed has been done in many countries across the world, is to ensure that there's a percent for art regime in place through the planning system that enables local authorities and local communities to get the investment that they all desperately need, as they don't just recover from the pandemic, but we see new opportunities across our communities.
Minister.
I absolutely recognise the vital role that culture plays in our communities. Indeed, last week I was visiting Dundee Waterfront, where we see the transformational impact of the V&A, and this is something that is referenced in our position statement that we published last year, alongside the developments that are taking place in Paisley, another example of Scottish Government investment in arts and culture supporting regeneration. And of course, the Government is committed to taking forward the percentage for arts scheme, but this is a complex area that will require consideration. So I look forward to Ms Boyack's engagement on that, just as I look forward to her engagement on the draft National Planning Framework 4 when it is laid before Parliament in the autumn.
Question number 6, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its programme for mental health within the NHS Recovery Plan.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We published our NHS Recovery Plan on Wednesday, the 25th of August, and we will update on our programme for delivery of these commitments in due course. The plan commits to ensuring that at least 10% of frontline health spending will be dedicated to mental health, with at least 1% directed specifically to services for children and young people by the end of this parliamentary session. The plan also commits to 1,000 additional staff in primary care, meaning every GP practice will have access to a mental health and wellbeing service.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for that reply. This week, Audit Scotland shared serious concerns about the way in which the children and young people's mental health is being cared for across Scotland. Indeed, the number waiting more than a year for treatment trebled in the last 12 months. And yet, the NHS Recovery Plan said CALM's waiting lists will be cleared by 2023. Will the Minister give assurances to this chamber that the people waiting will have access to the best care and there won't be young people parked on medication or referred to online interventions as a means of clearing this target?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should say to the member that so far this year we've already invested an additional £29.1 million from the Recovery and Renewal Fund into child and adolescent mental health services to help clear backlogs. But beyond that, Presiding Officer, one of the things that the government wants to ensure is that folks do not have to access these services in the first place. And that's one of the reasons why our investment will look at the well-being of children across the board so that no child reaches the crisis point of having to access CAMHS. And I'm very pleased that as we move forward, there will be a much greater focus on community help in all of this and in using digital sources as well, including cognitive behaviour therapies online, which can help us achieve that to stop that crisis point from happening.
Fiona Hislop.
Does the Minister agree that supporting NHS recovery with more community and voluntary sector-based therapies for 18 to 25-year-olds will help in preventing escalation of mental health issues for a significant number of young people in the future? But what can be done immediately to cope with demands now when escalation does happen? I'm seriously concerned that a lack of beds in Lothian for severe eating disorders is denying my constituents the acute life-saving treatments that they need. And can the Minister agree to look urgently into the inpatient mental health treatment provision?
Minister.
I thank Ms Hislop for what is a very important question. And we recognise that not all young people need specialist services like CAMHS. And that's why we've provided an additional £15 million of funding to local authorities to deliver locally based mental health and wellbeing support for 5 to 24-year-olds in their communities. I want to assure Ms Hislop that I've been in contact with NHS Lothian about the concerns that have been raised by her constituents. And I also want to share with the Chamber that we have already committed an additional £5 million of resource to support the delivery of the recommendations from the National Review of Eating Disorder Service, with a majority of that funding going directly to health boards to increase the help because of an increased presentation of folk with eating disorder requirements. And we expect all boards, including NHS Lothian, to prioritise that spend to get it right for patients.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions.